The following program, The Russ Belville Show, is intended for responsible adults only. We advocate to the repeal of marijuana prohibition for adults. We discuss the science, culture, and controversy about America's marijuana laws. We do not advocate any illegal activity and encourage all listeners to learn their state and federal marijuana laws. Opinions and claims made by guests and advertisers on The Russ Belville Show are their own, and The Russ Belville Show cannot be held legally responsible for their validity or reliability. Viewer discretion is advised.
You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it,
and it goes down smooth. Hey!
Spanning the continent to bring you the truth about cannabis and marijuana law reform.
I smoke pot and I like it a lot.
From the promise of legalization. To the agony of prohibition.
One major responsibility is to encourage people to use less drugs.
The Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
I hear you had a question for me.
Now, here's your host, Radical Russ Belville.
Good day, tokers and tokettes, and welcome to the show. It is Tuesday, December 3rd, 2013, and it's got to be 420 somewhere in the world. Welcome, and we have so much to get to today. Let's just get right to it. Today in our radical rant, I'm more angry today and sad and frustrated than I have been in weeks or months, for sure. New Jersey Governor Chris Christie is the subject of today's rant, and his intransigence on medical marijuana has led to the death of a young child, and he needs to be held accountable, held responsible for this. We'll tell you all about it in the Radical Rant at 45 after. Also on today's show, we are going to do some drug war data mining, a new segment we're going to have here on the Russ Belville Show. At half past, we're going to show you how to get rehab data from government databases and use that to help our case for marijuana legalization. So stay tuned for that, a little how-to lesson at half past. Also on today's show, it's time for our daily Toker Tunes for Electric Tuesday. That means we got Electric Bob calling in, and he's got a song for us today from 808 State that we're going to take a listen to when we get to our 20 after break. Also, we're going to go behind the headlines and take a look at Florida's medical marijuana amendment, which is currently in jeopardy as it's being challenged before the Florida Supreme Court. We'll tell you why and what happened to make that challenge a very likely possibility. We will take a look at that in Behind the Headlines, which comes right after our 420 radio news. And in the headlines today, we've got a lot of news coming from Denver, Colorado, including the latest vote on whether or not people will be able to smoke pot on their own property, in their own backyards or front porches, if people can see them. We'll take a look at the massive energy demand that the warehouses in Colorado are currently pulling from the electrical grid. And we've got an update on those federal DEA raids that took place in Denver that allegedly had ties to Colombian drug cartels. We also have two stories about strokes, one on synthetic pot and young people, and another story on how cannabis may help the victims of stroke. Plus, we'll take it into Hour 2, Toker Talk Radio, where you can call in live at 971-533-7111. We've also got our live chat room open at Ustream. You can visit that. Just get in there and type /login to create yourself an account and discuss the show with the other folks listening today live. Again, thanks for joining us. Thanks for supporting 420 Radio. We'll take a break, and we'll be right back with the news.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow.
simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business.
I'm Radical Russ Belville, and I want to thank you for listening to 420 Radio. We couldn't survive without you and our sponsors, and I'd like you to check out one of our prime sponsors, the National Cannabis Coalition. I've been working with NCC since June of 2012, and I'm proud to be part of the team they have assembled. National Cannabis Coalition is building the partnerships with reformers, lawmakers, and industry we need to be successful. Visit the National Cannabis Coalition website at nationalcannabiscoalition.com or the easier-to-remember ncc420.com. That's where you'll get the exclusive first look at my radical rants, as well as informative articles from the nation's top cannabis pundits. Visit ncc420.com today, and if you have your phone handy, text Russ to 420-420 to support NCC and 420 Radio. It's a free text message that helps us help you end adult marijuana prohibition. Learn more at ncc420.com, and thanks for supporting independent marijuana legalization public radio. The law offices of Omar Figueroa would like to remind you to stand up for your rights. Please do not give up your precious liberties. There's nothing wrong with standing up for our constitutional rights, and in fact, it's the only way to honor the Constitution that recognizes our natural rights. Treat law enforcement with respect, and respect the Constitution by standing up for your rights. If you are detained or arrested, stand up for your rights by repeating, "I respectfully invoke all my legal and constitutional rights. I do not consent to any search and seizure. I want to remain silent, and I want to speak to my attorney, Omar Figueroa." Omar Figueroa has more than a decade of experience in federal and California courts and graduated from Yale University, Stanford Law School, and Trial Lawyers College. Please contact the law offices of Omar Figueroa at 415-489-0420 or 707-829-0215. Or on the web at www.omarfigueroa.com. This is your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, December 3rd, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. Denver Council flips vote on pot smoking in front yards, from the Denver Post. The Denver City Council made a surprise move Monday, reversing an earlier decision that would have banned smoking marijuana on private property if it was in public view. If the bill passes on a final vote next week, Denver residents will be able to smoke on their front yards, front porches, or anywhere on their properties, regardless of whether it is visible from the street, sidewalk, or anywhere else. Councilwoman Susan Shepard, who on Monday offered the amendment that scrubbed the previous version of the bill, said the law banning front yard smoking was against the will of the people, infringed on private property rights, and was unfair to people depending on the type of property they own. Councilman Albus Brooks, who supported the front yard ban a week before, changed his vote Monday. He said that during the Thanksgiving break, he received calls from city leaders urging him to switch. He said he thought about the implications of police having to enforce that law. Synthetic pot, popular among teens, may be linked to strokes, from Huffington Post. A synthetic marijuana popular among teens may cause strokes, a University of Southern Florida study found. USF neurologists published news of the possible link in the journal Neurology after a brother and sister, aged 26 and 19, suffered acute ischemic strokes shortly after smoking the synthetic marijuana street drug known as Spice or K2. The researchers ruled out any undiagnosed genetic condition that would predispose the siblings to strokes at such a young age. Senior study author W. Scott Bergen told the Tampa Bay Times that since submitting to the journal, he has seen two more cases of stroke in unrelated patients that were likely spice-induced. This isn't the first time synthetic marijuana has been linked to serious health risks. A study in February out of the University of Alabama at Birmingham linked the product to acute kidney injury. In spite of the risks, the synthetic cannabis is immensely popular among teens. A 2011 survey conducted by the National Institute on Drug Abuse found that it was second only to real marijuana as the most used illicit drug among high school seniors. Marijuana warehouse is creating massive energy demand and emissions, from CBS Local in Denver. When John Koser opened his latest Excel energy bill and saw the cost, $21,500 for 1 month of electricity and climate control, he didn't complain to the utility, he simply paid it. It's the cost of doing business for Koser and others in the medical marijuana business. While Koser's monthly $21,500 bill is attention-grabbing, he told CBS4 one of his competitors pays a monthly utility bill of $100,000 per month for their warehouse grow operations. According to a 2011 study on energy use in the marijuana industry, indoor pot production uses about $6 billion worth of energy every year, using enough electricity to power 2 million average homes. The study by researchers Evan Mills at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory reports the marijuana industry is using 1% of national electricity consumption and is creating greenhouse gas pollution equivalent to that of 3 million cars. Cannabis may help stroke recovery by improving brain functions after the attack, from Huffington Post UK. Cannabis may help to reduce brain damage after a stroke, new research suggests. Chemical compounds found in the plant could help shrink the area of the brain affected by stroke, the study suggests. The study, which is to be presented at the annual UK Stroke Forum, examined previous studies that have been conducted on the effect of the compounds. They will tell the annual meeting that the chemicals show promise as a neuroprotective treatment for stroke. But experts caution that the effects of cannabis on the brain are highly complex and called for more research to see whether the same effect is noted in humans. Federal judge grants $25,000 bail to Colorado marijuana raid suspect, from the Denver Post. A federal judge said Monday he will allow a suspect arrested in connection with major federal raids on medical marijuana businesses to be released on a $25,000 bail. Diaz, the person arrested, is the only person arrested so far in connection with the largest federal raids on medical marijuana businesses ever in Colorado. Diaz, age 49, and a citizen of Columbia, was arrested after a SWAT raid on a swanky Cherry Hills Village home, during which authorities also encountered and tackled a man holding a loaded gun, according to court documents and testimony. Sources have told the Denver Post that the raids targeted an operation that investigators suspect may have ties to Colombian drug cartels, but Diaz has not been charged with marijuana-related crimes. Instead, he faces one count of being in possession of a firearm after entering the country on a non-immigrant visa. This has been your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, December 3rd, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. When we come back, we go behind the headlines to take a look at Florida's medical marijuana amendment and the challenge to it at the Florida Supreme Court that may doom it before voters ever get a chance to vote on it. You're listening to The Russ Belville Show on 420radio.org. We'll be right back. Cannabis Outreach Collective is an alternative health and wellness option located in Gladstone, Oregon, that serves patients in the Portland area and beyond. We are a full-service alternative health and wellness collective accommodating patients with natural, organic, holistic, and homeopathic remedies, nutritional guidance, advice, education, and medical cannabis, fully in accordance with Oregon OMMP law. You can find out more about Cannabis Outreach Collective on Facebook at COC503 or by emailing cannabisoutreachcollective503@gmail.com or by telephone at 503-853-1319. Check out our menu on Weed Maps and visit Cannabis Outreach Collective today.
No Herb Thrasher from the Herb Thrasher Flower Hour. Now get ready for Herb Age Designs for the proud cannabis consumer. Herb Age Designs, lifestyle gear for the 420 friendly. Herb Age Designs, home of the famous lighter leash. Herb Age Designs, get your Herb Age t-shirts and hoodies and show your pride. Herb Age Designs, we've got frisbee golf discs and durable hemp gear. Herb Age Designs. We've got shot glasses, drinking glasses, coffee mugs, and beer cozies. Check us out on Facebook and online at herbagedesigns.com and follow Herb Age and Herb Thrasher on Twitter. We'll see you at this year's Hemp Fest. Crank it up!
Welcome back, everyone. 15 after the hour and time for us to go behind the headlines and take a look at Florida's medical marijuana amendment. The Kathy Jordan Medical Marijuana Act is currently in the signature gathering phase. The people that are united to try to get this passed say they have about half the signatures they need already. And of course, John Morgan, the high profile, high dollar attorney in Orlando, who is currently backing Charlie Crist to become the next governor of the state. He's thrown a lot of money behind this, about $600,000, and plans to have about $1 million or more to continue the fight. However, before we ever get a chance to tally all the signatures, get it on the ballot, campaign for it, and get medical marijuana passed as a constitutional amendment in the state of Florida, we have a major hurdle to overcome. This week at the Florida Supreme Court, they are hearing arguments having to do with the ballot summary and other issues that may cause the Florida Supreme Court to declare this amendment unconstitutional and refuse to allow it to go forward on the ballot. What's at stake here is the definitions that have to do with who can get medical marijuana. The Speaker of the House there in Florida, Republican Will Weatherford, and understand that Florida is a Republican-controlled state right now, said his opposition stems only from concerns about how the ballot proposal is constructed, according to WOKV radio, I think, in Florida. He said, quote, this is what he told the Palm Beach Post, quote, "It's misleading to voters, flawed, and doesn't really tell you just how pervasive marijuana would be in this state. If this were approved, it would be a nightmare for the legislature to implement," end quote. And what is at issue here before the Florida Supreme Court is whether or not the ballot summary is misleading to the voters. And in particular, the part of the ballot summary, I'll read to you the full ballot summary, is this. This law would allow the medical use of marijuana for individuals with debilitating diseases as determined by a licensed Florida physician. Allows caregivers to assist patients' medical use of marijuana. The Department of Health shall register and regulate centers that produce and distribute marijuana for medical purposes and shall issue identification cards to patients and caregivers. Applies only to Florida law. Does not authorize violations of federal law or any non-medical use, possession, or production of marijuana. That's the summary the Florida Supreme Court is looking at. And the major part is at the very beginning there where it says, allows the medical use of marijuana for individuals with debilitating diseases as determined by a licensed Florida physician. Attorney General Pam Bondi, who's also a Republican, has challenged this law in front of this summary in front of the Florida Supreme Court because of what she says is misleading language. She says that this only for debilitating diseases is obfuscating the fact that this medical marijuana amendment would actually allow medical marijuana for almost any condition. Here's the definition as written in the medical marijuana amendment. For the purposes of this section, the following words and terms shall have the following meanings. A debilitating medical condition means cancer, glaucoma, positive status for human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, acquired immune deficiency syndrome, AIDS, hepatitis C, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS, Crohn's disease, Parkinson's disease, multiple sclerosis, or other conditions for which a physician believes that the medical use of marijuana would likely outweigh the potential risks, health risks for a patient. And that last clause, other conditions for which a physician believes the medical use of marijuana would likely outweigh the potential health risks for a patient, is what Pam Bondi is pointing to, saying that basically that is a very California-like statement. Of course, California famously in 1996 allowed Prop 215 to go forward with the language that said any other condition that a doctor believes marijuana can assist with. She believes that this would cause the same effect in Florida, where basically anybody who's got $40 in a story can find a doctor who's willing to recommend them medical marijuana. Now, this was brought up by one of the legislators there in Florida, and Florida's PolitiFact looked at this statement and agreed basically with the Attorney General and the Republicans in the State House that there was some fudging going on here with this ballot summary, that it was kind of confusing to people that would think it was only for cancer and AIDS and Hep C and so on, but would be allowed for just about any condition. Now, of course, I support medical marijuana for any condition, but if the Florida Supreme Court decides this is misleading, nobody will get medical marijuana in Florida. So it just goes to point out here that be careful how you construct these laws and these ballot initiatives, because trying to get clever and trying to sneak in any possible condition might mean that nobody gets medical marijuana, and that doesn't help us. All right, we got to take back break. When we come back, we've got Electric Bob on the line for our daily Toker Tunes.
If he said he swam to China, he would sell you South Carolina. Then you know you're talking to that reefer man. I'm a reefer smoking man.
Woodpipe Smoke Shop and Speakeasy is your source for cannabis community gear in southern Wisconsin. Owners Brian and Tammy Wood are located in Kendall, just outside of Madison, and they've got everything for the smoking enthusiast, including a full assortment of pipes, water pipes, hookahs, bubblers, one-hitters, and so much more. They're open noon to 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday and can help you with your detoxification therapies as well. Call 608-466-7473 or email woodpipes@yahoo.com for more information. That's 608-466-7473 or email woodpipes@yahoo.com. And as always, go Pack, go.
I'm Sub Cool from Team Green Avenger. At TGAGenetics.com, we are working on the leading edge of medical strains. Our strains are rigorously tested for THC, CBD, THCV, and other critical cannabinoids. Know your grow. Check out our genetic diversity at TGAGenetics.com, the home of Jelly Bean, Jack the Ripper, Vortex, and other award-winning cannabis strains.
Marijuana legalization is always on 420radio.org. Be sure to join us for our late night 10 p.m. Pacific lineup, beginning on Monday nights at 10 with Drug Truth Network, Dean Becker out of Houston, Texas. Tuesdays at 10 p.m., Cannabis Cure TV with our friend Greg DeHote from Sussex, England. On Wednesdays at 10 p.m., Green Stream Podcast from Olympia, Washington. And Thursdays at 10 p.m., Hemp Beach TV from the secret location undisclosed. That's our regular weekday lineup at 10 p.m. late nights Pacific time here on 420radio.org. Make sure to check out our weekend lineups as well, featuring the music shows Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink, Herb Thrasher Flower Hour, Red Eyes Reggae Flashback, and the new Viper Hour in 2-hour blocks back to back every weekend here on 420radio.org.
Everyone knows music and marijuana go together, so let's wind up our 20 after break with the Russ Belville Show's Daily Toker Tunes, the best in pod safe 420 music from around the web. Today is Electric Tuesday, featuring the latest in electronic dance music and other cutting edge genres. You can get downloads and more information about all our daily Toker Tunes by visiting music.radicalrust.com. Now, sit back and enjoy your daily Toker Tune.
Welcome back, everybody, and just a reminder that tomorrow's show will be coming to you live from Phoenix, Arizona, either at Sky Harbor Airport or in Tempe at the Lax Lounge. We're still working out the details of who's picking up whom and how I'm getting there, but we're going to get there. So tomorrow's show coming to you from Arizona. And speaking of Arizona, we've got an Arizonan on the line with Electric Bob for our Electric Tuesday. How you doing, Bob?
I'm doing good. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Can't wait to get in the air and get to some warm states. That's going to be fun.
Right, yeah. It's about 70 outside right now. It's been nice today.
Looking forward to it. All right, so we've got our Electric Tuesday music today, and of course that's all of our electronic and experimental music, and it looks like you got us a great track for today. Why don't you tell us about it?
This is 808 State. They're out of Manchester, England. They formed in 87, and they take their name from the Roland, the TR-808 drum machine. And they're one of the pioneering acts of like the acid house music back in the day.
Uh-huh.
And they were pretty big from 87 to 93, and then they just kind of dropped off the map. They put out another album in 2002, and then they dropped off the map again. There hasn't been much heard from these guys since.
Okay, well, that happens from time to time, but one of the nice things about all this electronic music is we usually find these guys turning up in other bands or other groups and remixing for other people, so I'm sure they'll be around. This song, Time Bomb 808 Tape Mix, and I, by the way, speaking of that drum machine, I used to have one of those drum machines. So that's the other thing.
I want to get one for myself, but they're expensive now since everyone bought them up and they're sitting there keeping them.
Yeah, exactly.
You can't get that sound out of any other drum machines anymore.
I know. It's a great unit, and I'm looking forward to it. I imagine they must have used that drum machine on this track. Is that a good assumption?
I'm guessing. And this is off their 93 release, Gorgeous. It's off their 93 LP. But yeah, there's a lot of percussion in this track. It's a little different than their normal stuff. But I just picked it because it's higher and has a lot of percussion.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's check it out. This is 808 State.
We'll go into the track.
With Time Bomb, the 808 Tape Mix. And Bob, we'll see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, Russ.
All right.
Time Bomb. We'll be right back.
What makes something funny? How does humor impact health and psychological well-being? How can you incorporate humor into everyday life? A concise, reader-friendly introduction to an important but often underappreciated topic in modern psychology, Humor 101 explains the role of comedy, jokes, and wit in the sciences and discusses why they are so important to understand. Psychology professor Dr. Mitch Earlywine draws from his personal experiences in stand-up comedy to focus on how humor can regulate emotion, reduce anxiety, and diffuse tense situations, expose pretensions, build personal relationships, and much more. He irreverently debunks the pseudoscience on the topic of humor and leaves readers not only funnier, but better informed. It's part of the Psych 101 series from Springer Publishing, Humor 101 by Dr. Mitch Earlywine, Ph.D.
420radio.org presents Cannabis Cure TV with Greg DeHote from Sussex, England, exploring medical marijuana and marijuana legalization in Europe and the U.K. every Tuesday night at 10 p.m. Pacific, with replays Wednesday at 11 a.m., Thursday at 4 a.m., and Saturdays at 7 a.m., right here on 420radio.org.
Reforming America's prohibition laws cannot happen without relentlessly and directly engaging our lawmakers and other elected officials. The Russ Belville Show keeps you on top of all the latest developments at the federal, state, and local level with Our Government at Work.
All right, welcome back, everybody. Time for Our Government at Work, and today we're taking a look at the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, part of our federal government that keeps track of the data on a lot of issues having to do with mental health. But in our particular case, we're interested in drugs. We're interested in what they're keeping track of on drugs, drug use, and for today's show, we're going to do a how-to on drug rehab data. If you'd like to follow along, I've got a handy link for you to be able to get to the SAMHSA website. If you go to rad-r.us/420data, and you got to capitalize the D in data, rad-r.us/420data, you can follow along with this website that we've got on screen, which is the Substance Abuse Mental Health Services Administration Data Archive. Now, as we look at this data archive, there's a series, they call them series, which are the different tests and the different surveys and such that they, and studies that they have and different databases. So within these series, you're going to find a few that are very interesting to us, and most particularly the National Survey on Drug Use and Health, or the NSDUH. This is the survey that provides us the information on how many people have smoked pot, how old were they when they smoked pot, and so how often they smoke pot, and so forth. And we've gone through that a few times here on the show. There's also the treatment episode data set, and that's what we're working with today. There are two different sets of the treatment episode data set. They're known as admissions and discharges. Admissions, of course, people that are being admitted to rehab. Discharges would be people that are leaving rehab. The TEDS A is the one that we're interested in today. This is the one that's going to give us the information on people that are put into rehab. When you open that treatment episode data set, you're going to see a lot of different folders for it for the different years that have been tracked. This data goes all the way back to 1992 and is recent up to 2011. You only need to click on one of those to see more information. All sorts of information on the code book, which is basically how they did the test, how they administered it, what the variables are, who were tested, and so forth. But the information, the main part that's going to help us out is this thing that says online analysis, and it's highlighted for you. It's impossible to miss. Now, before we get into this treatment episode data set data, we do need to issue a bit of a disclaimer in that this does not represent everyone who is in rehab. It only represents the people that are in rehabs that are funded through public dollars. This is a government database, so they're tracking, you know, how their money is being spent. So that represents about 58% of all rehabs and rehab clients turn out to be the ones that are in public rehabs. This data will not represent people that are in private rehabs. And understand, part of the difference here is that private rehabs are more likely to have people that are well-to-do, that are able to pay for their rehab through their insurance, their health insurance, or have enough money to be able to just pay for it out of pocket. Whereas the TEDS A data, the public rehabs, that's the ones that people get sentenced to. That's the ones that when you're forced to go to rehab for your probation or whatever, you're going to go to probably one of these public rehabs. So keep in mind, this data is just for those people, so it might be skewed a little bit compared to the data of the people that are going to the private rehabs. Still, this gives us a good look at how much the drug war is affecting our rehab statistics. Clicking on the SDA link will then take us to a place to set up our guest credentials, and it's basically a terms of use page where you have to agree to privacy and how to cite the data and the disclaimers and so forth, basic definitions. And once you just agree to that, you'll be led to the next page, which is going to be the table generation page. The way these interfaces work is that on the left-hand side of the screen, you're going to see a series of books, these little books that represent the different characteristics that we might want to be looking at. Identification, client characteristics, geographic information, like which state is someone coming from, and so forth. Referral sources, treatment service characteristics, prior substance abuse treatment, mental health, their insurance and payment, how did they pay for their rehab? All of these things are available on the TEDS A data set. So, when you're looking at one of these books, there's usually a little plus sign next to it that you can open up to give yourself information on the variables that you have available to you. Identification shows us case ID and the year of admission. Client characteristics show us things like age, gender, race, ethnicity, marital status, and so forth. Trying to understand what any of these variables does, on the other hand, can be a little difficult because these codes don't have a quick and easy guide for you to understand what they're about. Now, you can look this stuff up. There is a help file for this. But what I've found in practical use is that just putting a variable onto the table and then running the table is usually the quickest way to be able to get some information. So, for example, we have age as a variable. Now, age, you'd think would be pretty simple. It'd be how old someone is, but sometimes these can be grouped together in age groups rather than individual ages. So if, for example, we were wanting to find out how many adults were put in rehab solely for the use of marijuana, we would have to know whether or not an adult is 21 or over or if that's a particular group. We need to know how age is put together. By clicking age, it will appear up in the top area where it says selected, and you can then copy that to row. And when you copy that to row, the variable age is going to appear on the right-hand side where we have row, column, control, selection filters, and so forth. These are the variables you're going to use to build your table. Now, you're only required to put in one variable. And by putting in one variable, you get the information back for the entire survey. So we will know by generating this table, what is the age range of the people that are in this database. To make this table happen, and there's a lot of detailed stuff on here about percentaging and charts and so forth, you can ignore this at first. Just get the idea of how the variables work and how the tables work at first. Then once you're comfortable with that, you can play around with some of the other options. So we're going to take age in the row, and if you scroll down a bit, you'll see run the table. When we click run the table, a new tab will open up, giving us the data information, treatment episode data set, TEDS A data from 2011 for the age variable, the recoded age variable. And it was a good thing that we looked this up because you'll find that the age has been broken down into categories. Age 2 represents people that are 12 to 14. Age 3 represents people 15 to 17. Age 4, 18 to 20, age 5, 21 to 24, and so on. So if we are looking for just adults, we need this to be ages 5 and above. Everybody from 21 to 24 and older. So now we have the idea of what we want for our ages, ages 5 and above. Now, let's take a look at other variables. We now know how to pick out adults. How are we going to pick out people who have used marijuana? If we scroll down, you'll find substances of abuse, original variables, and substances of abuse, created variables. I like to use the created variables because they're usually recoded and have better ways for you to find information out. Here is a variable that's called MARFLAG, M-A-R-F-L-G, and it stands for marijuana or hashish reported at admission. Now, that doesn't mean it's only marijuana and hashish. Could be coming in with marijuana, alcohol, heroin, LSD, could be addicted to a lot of things. But marijuana flag will tell us if marijuana is one of those things. Now, clicking on MARFLAG, we'll put it up there in the selected section. Replace is currently selected, so when I click on row, it will replace age with MARFLAG. And then again, we'll just run the table. This will tell us that of all the people that ever went to rehab, 61.7% of them did not report using marijuana. Only 38.3% reported that they used marijuana. But this, again, since we're only using one variable, represents everybody, all ages. We need to narrow that down a bit. Now, if we keep MARFLAG in the row section and then put age in the column section, now we're making a table with two variables and we can cross-reference whether or not they use marijuana with how old they are. Running that table will show us all of the age groups across the top, and then whether or not that age group is using marijuana and getting admitted to rehab for that. And what we find is that 82.8% of the 12 to 14 year olds that are in rehab have used marijuana, have reported marijuana. And that rises to 88.5% when we talk about kids 15 to 17. But notice that once we hit the 21 to 24 age group, which is at 50.4%, the marijuana substance reported drops in every age group from that point on. This would lead me to believe that we're overemphasizing the catching of kids and putting them into rehab for marijuana versus adults. But again, remember that this is all marijuana, even if they also used alcohol or other drugs. What if we only wanted to find the people who were using just marijuana? Fortunately, there is another feature that we have that is a part of this. I'm going to take age out of the columns. And that is this variable under substances of abuse created variables called NUMSUBS, which stands for the number of substances reported at admission. Now, NUMSUBS, if we put that in the column section, we'll be checking out whether or not someone was flagged for marijuana and how many substances they were using. Running that table tells us that if someone reported one substance, if they were only using one drug, 18.2% of them were admitted for marijuana. Compared to people admitted for two or three drugs, where that number jumps to 49.4 and 63% respectively. Now, when we use the column feature, this gives us all of the values for number of substances. We're getting 0, 1, 2, and 3. What if instead of cross-referencing all the values, we just wanted to know one value? And in this case, how many of these people are only in for marijuana? That would be a combination of people flagged for marijuana where the number of substances only equals one. Now, this involves another part of the variables here, and that is something called selection filters. Selection filters allow you to filter the data by a particular variable. So if we take NUMSUBS out of column and put it into selection filters, and then in parentheses you specify what you're trying to select. And in our case, we want the number of substances, one, you know, parenthesis, one parenthesis, to say only pick these MAR flags out if the number of substances was just one. Or in other words, only pick out the people who are there only for marijuana. And we run that table, and we find, like we found earlier, 18.2% of the people in rehab for marijuana alone of all the people in rehab. So of all the people in rehab, only less than one in five of them are there for pot alone. Now, remember earlier when we broke down the stuff by age, we found that there was a much bigger range of young people in that list. What if we were only looking for the adults who want to, the adults who were admitted there for marijuana only? You can have more than one selection filter. In this case, we keep num subs of one as it is, and we add age of 5 through 12. I didn't look at the top edge of age. I better find out exactly what that is. Hold on just one moment. Let's make, should have noted that earlier. I forgot what the top value was. The top value for age is 12. Okay. So from 5 through 12 is what we're looking for. So we'll put mar flag back in the row. We'll put num subs 1 and age 5 through 12 in the selection filter. So the only people that should come through are people flagged only for marijuana and they're over the age of 21. We run that table. We find out that adults who are there just for marijuana make up 10.5% of all people in rehab. Now, of those people that are in rehab, it might be interesting to know what put them there. Did these people choose to go to rehab? Or were they forced to go to rehab? We can do this by taking marflag and adding it to the selection filters. And marflag equal 1. So they're flagged for just, that it's a true. In a flag, it's either 0 for no and 1 for yes, right? And we have another variable that comes from the referral sources. And under referral sources, P source, principal source of referral, refers to what got you referred to rehab. Was it a court? Was it your school? Was it your employer? Or did you just choose to go yourself? We'll put that in row and run the table. And we will find that of adults who were put in rehab only for marijuana, only 13.9% of them admitted themselves. 55.7% of them were sent there by a court, criminal justice referral, DUI, or DWI. Which once again shows why Kevin Sabet and Big Rehab are so afraid of marijuana legalization. Because in order to make up for one person who doesn't get forced to rehab by a court, they'll have to have four more people who choose to go to rehab on their own. And folks, when it comes to marijuana, that's just not going to happen. So there's our look at the Substance Abuse Mental Health Data Archive and the TEDS A data. We'll be doing more of these how-to drug war data mining things every other Tuesday. So stay tuned for that. In a couple weeks, we'll do another one of these. If you have any suggestions for drug war data mining, send them to me here at 420radio.org. Use our contact form and let me know. When we come back, time for a radical rant.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show. The voice of the marijuana nation.
Cast your eyes up to the skies. What is it to live and die?
I helped murder families in Colombia.
It was just innocent fun.
I helped kidnap people's dads.
Hey, some harmless fun.
I helped kids learn how to kill.
I was just having some fun, you know.
I helped kill policemen.
I was just having fun.
I helped the bomber get a fake passport.
All the kids do it.
I helped kill a judge.
I helped blow up buildings.
My life. My body.
It's not like I was hurting anybody else.
Marijuana and alcohol are the two most popular recreational drugs in America. Marijuana smoking is non-toxic, relatively safe, and has a low risk of dependence. Alcohol drinking is potentially fatal, dangerous to society, and is quite addictive. Marijuana is safer, so why are we driving people to drink? That's the question of the new book, Marijuana is Safer, So Why Are We Driving People to Drink? By Paul Armentano, Mason Tvert, and Steve Fox. Visit Amazon.com or ChelseaGreen.com today to order your copy of Marijuana is Safer, or visit...
You want answers?
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
You want answers?
You have offended my family.
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
And you have offended a Shaolin temple.
You can't handle the truth!
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious. And don't call me Shirley.
Radical rant.
New Jersey Governor Chris Christie prefers dead kids over stoned adults. The governor of New Jersey, Chris Christie, was very concerned about his state's medical marijuana program. Quote, "I want New Jersey to be a compassionate state. And for people who this is your only option to get pain relief, for those who are terminally ill and are chronically ill, we've authorized it." End quote, the governor told the public. Paula and Phil were very concerned about their little baby girl, Sabina Rose. The 15-month-old was a darling child, but suffered from a rare form of epilepsy called Dravet syndrome. No pharmaceutical treatment would stop the severe seizures she would suffer sometimes multiple times per day. Soon, Paula and Phil found Megan and Brian Wilson, parents of another child with Dravet, who had been lobbying Governor Christie to expand access to medical marijuana for minors. Governor Christie would abide none of the talk of medical marijuana for kids. Quote, "I am not going to allow New Jersey to become a California or a Colorado where someone can fake a headache and get a bag of pot on every corner," said the governor. "So I'm very concerned if we go down this slope of allowing minors to use this, where it ends," end quote. Paula and Phil jumped over every ridiculously high hurdle Governor Christie's compassionate medical marijuana program created to restrict youth access. In New Jersey, unlike any other medical marijuana state, a doctor must register with the medical marijuana program. The doctor must register with the medical marijuana program in order to recommend cannabis. The couple found a registered doctor who was willing to help a 15-month-old patient. Not easy to do. Then the law required the couple to find a registered pediatrician for a second opinion supporting medical cannabis use for Sabina Rose. And they did. Then they had to find a registered psychiatrist for a third opinion agreeing with cannabis treatment, and they did, finally, sending their completed paperwork and $200 fee to the state early last week. Governor Christie had a chance to remove some of these hurdles when a bill reached his desk that would have eliminated the need for three doctors to approve medical marijuana for kids. He vetoed that part of the legislation, leaving parents with severely disabled children in New Jersey the difficulty of getting a first opinion from just 250 doctors registered in the state, a second opinion from one of two pediatricians registered in the state, and a third opinion from one of just 16 psychiatrists registered in the state. Now, Brian and Megan Wilson had been lobbying the governor for access to the breakthrough cannabis oil high in cannabidiol, or CBD, from the Charlotte's Web plant. Now, since the story of little Charlotte Feige aired on CNN's documentary Weed, and Dr. Sanjay Gupta was exposing people to this miracle, parents across the country whose children suffer from Dravet have been clamoring for this marijuana concentrate. Little Charlotte went from hundreds of seizures a week that threatened her cognitive development and her life to barely one seizure a week. And the CBD oil she uses, it's so low in THC, lawmakers in Utah of all places, are considering legal importation of that oil as a hemp product, akin to a hemp soap or a hemp lotion or hemp seeds that also cannot get the user high. Paula and Phil had hoped to try the CBD oil on Sabina Rose, but it's unavailable in New Jersey, partially thanks to severe cultivation restrictions Governor Christie put in place for the state's one medical marijuana grow site. Restrictions that at one time included limiting the cultivation of marijuana to just three strains. Now, fortunately, that's been changed recently. And that those strains must produce less than 10% THC. Now, to provide some emergency relief for the children of parents like Paula and Phil and Megan and Brian, lawmakers recently introduced a bill that would allow registered patients in New Jersey to travel to other medical marijuana states like Colorado and bring back the cannabis oil medicine to save their children's lives. Governor Christie blasted that move yesterday, saying, quote, "See, this is what happens. Every time you sign one expansion, then the advocates will come back and ask for another one. Here's what the advocates want. They want legalization of marijuana in New Jersey. It will not happen on my watch ever. I am done expanding the medical marijuana program under any circumstances, so we're done." End quote. On November 27th, Sabina Rose suffered a seizure that lasted 25 hours. Despite using all of the pharmaceutical rescue medications at the hospital's disposal, Sabina Rose had to be placed into a medically induced coma with severe brain damage. Sabina Rose died yesterday as Governor Christie was telling reporters, quote, "There's no outpouring of people signing up for this program. This is another one of those narrow groupthink policies put forward by the legislature, and I'm not going to continue to expand it because what they want is legalization. They're not getting legalization under this governor," end quote. Regardless of where one stands on the legalization of adults getting high on marijuana, one must understand that the CBD oil these parents are fighting for will never get anyone high and will save children's lives. Unless one is Governor Chris Christie, who'd rather let kids die than let adults get high. And when this story came across my desk this morning, it just reminds me why I do this every day, and why you're out there listening every day, and why we're fighting every day. For God's sake, Mormons in Utah can accept this CBD oil, Chris Christie. Your complaint about what's the slippery slope does not hold water when we're talking about an oil extract of high CBD oil that doesn't get anyone high. You are pandering to what you think the voters want to hear, which, by the way, you're going to find in a very rude awakening is not what the voters want to hear. The voters are ahead of you on medical marijuana, Governor Christie. And the only thing this can be seen as is rank cruelty and indifference to the suffering of children, Mr. Christie. I don't know how you sleep with yourself at night. I don't know how your conscience allows you to take another breath knowing that you obstructed a 15-month-old girl from possibly receiving the best treatment ever, non-toxic, that would knock out her seizures and allow her to live a full, fruitful, healthy, wonderful life. That's on you, Governor Christie. And every kid who dies in New Jersey from here on out, that's on you. That's all the time we got for today. Thanks for joining us. We'll take this into hour two, Toker Talk Radio, me and Brian the Red hanging out. And until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you try it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you